Imagine trying to buy a house without a mortgage. It may take a while, right? If you're one of those few that don't need a mortgage, the video may not be for you, but I'm here to explain the reasoning of why Fannie, Freddie, and Ginnie were created by the government. Now, they're not government-owned entities anymore. There's a long history of kind of how they got started, what their middle ground looks like, and where they're at today. So what we'll do is we'll take a little dive into what that looks like. So around the time of the Great Depression, things were hard, right? Money was scarce, people were scared. There wasn't a lot of trust in the banks because the money had kind of went away. So what the government decided to do was allow people to sell mortgages. And think of it like this. You've got the banks and they give out the money. Well, that money is tied up essentially for 30 years. If you make it less, more like 5-10 years, the banks get their money back sooner, but your payment's also going to be a lot higher, making affordability lower, which was the exact problem they're trying to solve. So what we're looking at here with these entities is it allows for them to have a certain set of rules. So imagine this. Fannie and Freddie and Ginnie are like referees. They make the rules, they call the shots, they say what goes and what doesn't. Well, everything that does go can get sold back to them. And that's where we get into mortgage-backed securities and the bond market and everything like that. But that'll be in a different video that we'll explain. So what we're, again, getting back to is these entities give money to the banks so that they can lend out. And then once that loan has been created, they sell it back and then they get more money. So then they can keep doing this while keep doing this. So I've got a pretty cool AI-generated photo for you. So if you look here, the spelling is not right, but I just wanted to show you an example of kind of how that works. I think there's another middle bank in there that doesn't match up. You know, just trying to play around with the AI bit of it. But that was created so that we can get more affordability in homes. And that is where the American dream really came to fruition. The white picket fence was figuring out a job that was able to pay enough for what you got, as well as afford a 30-year mortgage. That over the course, because remember, people used to stay at the same company for that whole tenure. So by the time that they retire, their house is paid off, they've got some money in the savings, the American dream. And so over time, you know, these entities were sold, you know, and privatized, and they all do a different segment of things, right? So like Fannie, they deal with, in general, a lot of the bigger banks, the larger corporations, a lot more of, say, the A-paper loans, you know, very cut, clear, W-2, 740 credit, things like that. Freddie Mac, which, you know, does the LP side of things, they're more known for doing the smaller banks, the unions, things like that, that have a little bit more leniency in terms of the rules. Because while everybody may not fit inside Fannie's box, it doesn't mean that they're not going to pay their mortgage, right? So when we're looking at things like that, that's why there's the different entities. And then to get into it further, Fannie Mae sells certain parts of their loans. So you can have the note, but then to have the servicing rights, you get money based off that servicing rights. So they sold those, which becomes a big deal in 2008. And then Freddie kept theirs. So through 2008, when things went down, Freddie Mac still had income coming in from the servicing of those loans. So every month people paid, Freddie got money, Freddie Mac, that company got money, so they were able to stay afloat. Fannie had to end up selling the actual loans themselves as well to different entities, the mortgage-backed securities and things like that, to stay afloat during that time. Now, Ginnie Mae is made for those that serve the United States. And I don't just mean on the battlefield, but also for agriculture as well. So they do help with the USDA and the VA loans. Now, these are a little bit different because those are government guaranteed loans. So it is different than the, you know, conventional side of things, as you will, you know, and dealing with the FHA side of it. So then that makes it an even broader scope. So with Ginnie Mae doing the FHA, they have a different set of rules. So mortgage insurance with Fannie and Freddie, it's completely dependent on what property you have and all these other matrices. You know, is there a non-occupant co-borrower? Are there any of these other things that come into play with how much the mortgage insurance is for those less than 20% down? Which, you don't need 20% down to buy a home, just a reminder. The FHA side, it's a lot more standardized. You know, they looked at things, and so no matter whether you have a 780 credit score or a 600 credit score, your mortgage insurance is going to be the same for an FHA loan. So a couple of those key points, and you know, it's, you're looking at buying a home, you're trying to figure it out, you see Fannie, Freddie, Ginnie, what type of loan do we need? Well, if you work with a mortgage broker, you're going to be put into the best loan for you and your family at that time, as well as for your goals. So don't necessarily worry too much about this, but this is just an informational video. So it kind of brings awareness to kind of how this market was created and how it's proceeding here in the future. So all the time they have different guidelines because we as a society are changing. I mean, 10 years ago, there was no Uber Eats. So how do you classify somebody that gets paid through 3 to 4 different companies, Uber Eats, DoorDash, I don't know, you probably know another one. So, you know, things change all the time. So the guidance on how to loan money for United States citizens and others, it comes to play with these programs, right? So they're really important. I'm a mortgage broker. We sell loans. We get people into homes, right? But unfortunately, I'm not at the point where I could give somebody $400,000 and say, pay me back over the next 30 years. You know, not many people can do that. And not many people can do that at scale. As well as, you know, you'd have your money tied up for 30 years. That's just crazy. So the government has created a system to where we as citizens can benefit from that. So that's a general idea about how this works. And if you're curious, we'll have other videos that kind of come up. So stay tuned and thank you for watching. This is Miles Nelson at Summerlin Financial.